Hey, welcome to the video tutorial Starting with Data. This tutorial is for beginners in software development who want to learn just enough to access data on the web and visualize it on their own websites or mobile device applications. The files used in this tutorial are available on GitHub with the link provided. Please download them if you'd like to follow along. You know the internet is full of information. News, weather, sports, history, dating advice, dogs that look like their owners, and on and on. We're used to looking information up ourselves and consuming it in a manual way. It turns out, though, that there are a lot of providers who distribute information we can consume in an automated way. Google, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Amazon, Yahoo, The New York Times, ESPN, the United States government, and many more. If you know how to harness this information, what you can do with it is only limited by your imagination. There is a reason data science has become a thing. DonorsChoose is a wonderful online charity where you can donate to American public school teachers who don't have the funding they need to help their students learn. Many celebrities and well over a million ordinary Americans have made a difference in the lives of over 10 million students thanks to DonorsChoose. DonorsChoose also exposes their data for us to consume in an automated way. In fact, Comedy Central satirist Dr. Stephen T. Colbert, DFA, hosted a contest to find software applications that most creatively exploited DonorsChoose data. Before we learn how to do the same thing, we need to understand some terminology. Providers like DonorsChoose offer services that let you fetch different kinds of data depending on what you ask for. The set of rules for how you interact with these services is called an API. That stands for Application Programming Interface, but no one cares. An API defines how you ask a service to do something and what you can expect in return. After all, if you're going to write software to interact with these services, there have to be strict rules in place because software can't make judgments like a human can, at least not until Skynet is self-aware. These APIs are REST APIs. REST stands for Representational State Transfer, but no one cares about that either. REST is a big, complex topic. All you need to know for now is that fetching data with REST is exactly like fetching web pages in your browser. Think about how you do that. Typically, you click on a URL or type a URL in the address bar of your browser to fetch a web page. REST works the same way. You provide a URL, but instead of fetching a web page, you fetch data. What the URL looks like going in and what the data look like coming back are defined by the API. Anyone who uses a service, whether it's a person or code, is called a client of the service. So clients use URLs going in, but the typical format for data coming back is JSON. That stands for JavaScript Object Notation. You guessed it, no one cares. You are probably used to seeing data in one place, like a spreadsheet or a chart in a document. JSON is a format for moving data from one place to another, and since every modern programming language knows how to read and write JSON, two applications written in completely different languages can still communicate with it. This is why JSON is such a great fit for REST services. Now that we have our terminology straight, let's get back to DonorsChoose. Here's the DonorsChoose developer guide, which describes the APIs for their services. This might look a bit imposing, especially if you're new to this sort of thing. Don't worry about understanding details. Focus instead on the big picture for now. There's plenty of time to work out the details later. Here's a list of specific parameters the API needs. As you can see, the only required one is API key. Typically, you have to sign up to use a service, and when you do, the provider gives you a key to attach to your request for data. But DonorsChoose is nice enough to let us use the DonorsChoose key to test with. When we scroll down a bit, we start to see some examples of how to query the data. Here's an example of a search on music projects. Notice how the query looks just like a URL you use with a browser. In fact, let's just click on it and see what happens. And here's your first taste of what JSON looks like. That's a lot of stuff, so it might look overwhelming. But if you look at it carefully, you can see it really isn't that complicated. You see the search term and the total number of results. Look further, and you will see each project has a title and a description. Keep scrolling, and you will find the teacher's name, that this is a high-poverty project, where the school is, and a lot of other details. So now comes the fun part. Sometimes you will know exactly what you want to do, and it's just a matter of scanning the API documentation to see how to retrieve the data you want. Other times, you'll have no idea what you want to do, and like a shopper at the mall, you'll have to scan the API to see what strikes you. This first proposal gives me an idea. We can see this is a high-poverty project and where it's located. Let's see all the states with high-poverty projects. Can we do that? Look at the Special Categories section. There is a high-level poverty parameter. Setting it to true in your query request will fetch only high-poverty projects. Let's do that. The JSON looks just like before, except that instead of everything, only high-poverty projects are included. It would be pretty cool to present the states that have high-poverty projects on a map of the United States. The next questions are obvious. How can we do what we just did manually in an automated way? How do we get the data from DonorsChoose to our map? How do we even make a map? This is finally where we build something. Check out this gorgeous diagram to see what we're going to build. We already have the DonorsChoose REST service. We'll create a map that will show the states with high-poverty projects in blue. To do that, the map doesn't need all that JSON we saw in the response from DonorsChoose, just the information about the states. We need something between DonorsChoose and our map to filter out state data. We can build our own REST service just like DonorsChoose did. The map will call our service with a URL like we always do in REST. Then our service will call DonorsChoose with the URL we just used. They'll respond with all the high-poverty projects in JSON as we've seen. Our service will filter out just the state data and return the states in JSON to the map. The map will use that list to color those states blue. There are a lot of technologies we can use to build our map and REST service. For the map, we will use what every web page uses, HTML. We will also use a graphics technology called SVG and a JavaScript visualization library called D3. For our REST service, we will use the programming language Python and a REST library called Flask. As for DonorsChoose, I have no idea what they use to build their stuff. But as we said before, using JSON and REST means we don't have to know or care what DonorsChoose uses. I know this sounds like a lot, but you'll be amazed at how little code it will take to do this. Besides, like I said before, focus on the big picture and worry about the rest later. First, we need a map of the United States that we can color in code. The easiest way to do this is to use SVG, which stands for Scalable Vector Graphics, but no one cares. The details don't really matter, since we are just going to copy and paste. Seriously. To find an SVG map of the United States, just Google it, and you will find a zillion maps like this one. We can copy and paste the SVG markup into our own HTML like this. And now let's look at our web page in our browser. It's that easy to add a map. Now let's go back to the markup on the web page. Much like the JSON before, there is a lot of stuff in the SVG, but it isn't too complicated since it is just XML, which looks like HTML. Look at all these path elements and their IDs. You might notice the IDs are state abbreviations. Web developers know that you can use JavaScript to manipulate HTML elements by their IDs. We can do the same with SVG elements. If we want to turn Texas blue, for example, we just have to reference the path element with ID TX and turn it blue. This makes things a lot easier for us. The service we write only has to get the list of high-poverty projects from DonorsChoose, filter out the state abbreviations, and send them back to the map. Let's write this service. We chose Python for this. It just might be the best get-up-and-go language out there because it is both simple and powerful. Flask is a really nice Python library for building your own services without getting your hands dirty with that HTTP stuff and setting up a server and port and all that. Let's take a look at how to use Python and Flask to create a service that fetches the high-poverty projects from DonorsChoose and filters out the state abbreviations. In a lot of programming languages, we often dedicate blocks of code called functions to perform a particular task. Here, each function performs one service. Flask lets us easily map those services to a URL that a REST client, like our map, can call our service with. First, we have a service called test, where the URL is just a slash, and the result is just simple text. So if we make a call here, we see this. Now that we know we are set up okay, let's create a service that can be reached at /projects/high-poverty/states for our map to use. We assign that URL to a function called high-poverty-states. First, we use Python's urllib2 library to make the call to DonorsChoose. Then we use Python's JSON library to treat the response as JSON and not just random text. Now let's refresh our memory of what the response from DonorsChoose looks like. You can either check out the API documentation or just look at a sample response as we have here. You can see the response's proposals with the state abbreviations labeled state. So back in our service, we loop through all the proposals in the JSON and accumulate a list of state abbreviations while throwing away any duplicates, like if Texas shows up more than once. The last thing we do is turn that list into JSON so that the client, our map, can handle it. Let's take a look at what our service produces. You may not understand all the code, but look at how few lines it took to do stuff that seemed really complicated at first. It all comes down to just fetching data, grabbing what we want, and sending that back out. That's our service. The last thing we need to do is to have our map call our service and read the JSON that comes back to know which states to color blue. This is where D3 comes in. JavaScript is the programming language you use to make web pages do things, and D3 is the preeminent JavaScript library for visualizing data on the web. Let's take a look at how to use it with our map. As you can see, once again, it is just a few lines of code. First, we use D3 to grab the SVG element in our web page, which as you saw earlier contains our map. Then we use D3 to call our service. Notice how the URL we call matches the one we created for our service with Flask. Finally, when that list of state abbreviations comes back from our service, we tell D3 to loop over it. For each abbreviation, we find the path element inside the SVG map whose ID matches that abbreviation and color that state blue when we find it. That's it, we're done. At last, let's take a look at our map. As you can see, Texas and several other states are blue because they have high poverty projects in DonorsChoose. And with that, we have leveraged REST services, some SVG copy and paste, and only about 10 lines of code or so with Python in Flask and D3 to create an end-to-end application that fetches data, processes it, and renders a visualization to help others understand the data. I do have to come clean about one thing. As it turns out, we actually don't need to create a service with Python in Flask. Because filtering is so simple, we could have just used JavaScript by itself to make a REST call to DonorsChoose directly and filter out the states before rendering them on the map. But I wanted to show you how simple and powerful Python is, and a service like this one can come in handy when you want to do real analytics and other fun, more complex things. Let's summarize. There are services available all over the web to provide just about any kind of data you can imagine. These services have APIs that define how you can interact with them as a client, and you do so over REST, which feels just like viewing a web page in a browser. Every major programming language supports REST, and we used Python both to create our own REST service and to consume another, because Python is a great combination of simplicity and power. We didn't do any data science, but we did do some simple processing of the data and visualized it with SVG and D3 in an intuitive way. Once you take the time to understand all the code in detail, you can build on this to run analytics on your data to produce some really interesting results. We really hope you enjoyed this tutorial and learned enough to get started on your own REST service and data manipulation and visualization work. We just scratched the surface here. REST, Python, D3, Flask, and general application architecture are all rich topics, and we will explore them in greater detail in future tutorials and blog posts on the video website. We hope you'll check those out too. Thanks for watching. This has been Starting with Data by Vidya.